In this video, we will still be discussing exchanging Van up on material. This is a position I took from a game between Capablanca and Ragozin played at the Moscow International 1937. And this example illustrates perfectly how to convert a material advantage, because what Capablanca is doing here is making the position technical, so to say. Let's have a closer look at the position to see what is going on. White is up two pawns, but at the moment things are not yet completely clear, since especially the pin is rather annoying. The bishop on a7 is very poorly placed. And also black has the bishop pair, and those bishops are pointing in the direction of our king, and black might have some hopes for a kingside attack later. So white needs to play very precise here, and that's exactly what Capablanca did. And even though the next move might seem bad from a material point of view, because the next move, actually Capablanca is returning one of the pawns, I think it is very very clever what Capablanca did here. He played the move queen b5, and this move solves many problems, namely we unpin the bishop on a7, and we are exchanging queens, and when material up, usually it's good for us to exchange pieces. This is not a rule that you can just follow blindly. Unfortunately, chess is just too concrete a game for that, but such guidelines are really helpful and strong players use them, but all in all, chess, it is just a lot of calculation, and sometimes this kind of guidelines might really backfire. So if you only play chess according these kind of guidelines, then probably you will hit some wall, because chess doesn't really work that way all the time. But in this case it does work. Queen b5 is attacking the queen on h5 and also the bishop on b7, so black cannot really afford this exchange of queens, and that's what Ragozin did. He exchanged the queens and regained a pawn. Knight e4, rook takes e4 and bishop take e4. And now, since black is threatening to worsen our pawn structure with the move bishop take f3, here Capablanca played the move knight d2, and after bishop d3, he took on d6, and here this is an interesting moment, because black can actually take on a7 but also recapture on d6. And to probably many of you, it might seem a good idea to take the knight on d6, because in this case there are opposite color bishops, and we have already discussed one position in which there was also opposite color bishops in the previous video, a game between Lucas van Verrees and Robbie Cafasvili. And here I think the situation is very similar. Even though opposite color bishops usually tend to be draws, this mainly counts for pure opposite color bishop positions. And now there is also the presence of knights and rooks, so here I don't believe that black has any chance to hold a draw, since white now has also connected passed pawns, and white will push them slowly without allowing black to make some kind of blockade. So this position is really hopeless for black, and that's why Ragozin decided to take on a7. And now after knight 6e4, white is just a clear pawn up. So yes, Capablanca lost one pawn advantage compared to the starting position, But he managed to accomplish quite a lot of things, since in this position there are some serious threats, and in this position actually everything is very well protected. Also the White King is now very safe, and White is now basically technically winning. And Capablanca, he was very famous for his good endgame technique, converted without too many difficulties. Let us continue a bit, because there's one interesting thing involving exchanging that I would like also to discuss, because actually exchanging can be done just by putting the pieces on very good squares. The knight on c5 is tremendous, and White's other knight is heading for d4. So, yeah, Black cannot really live with such a strong knight on c5. So Black has to actually exchange this knight on c5. And this is probably a good thing to understand. By centralizing your pieces or putting your pieces on nice outposts, you're basically forcing your opponent to exchange those pieces, which is very good if you have a material advantage. So, and so have a knight e6, and here Capablanca doesn't even bother to take on e6. Just plays rook c1, since he understands that the knight on c5 is so strong, and why exchange on e6? I think it's even better for us if our opponents are making the exchanges, not we. So very clever. For example, if knight c5, rook c5, that would be much better than taking on e6 here. Yeah, right, because white rook is now on a1. Well, here already white has activated the rook and is hitting the bishop on f5. So usually if your opponent is offering exchange, think a bit. Do you really need to make this exchange, or will your opponent make this exchange for you? In which case it is better to make some useful move. So king f8 was played here, and now Capablanca decided to take on e6 anyway, and centralize the knight on d4. Rook b7, and now, yeah, the question is, should you take on e6, yes or no? And I will immediately give you the answer, probably no. And why not? There is one thing that should be understood, is that many rook endgames, even when you are one pawn up, are tend to be very drawish. And I can imagine that after knight e6, fe6, let's say white plays here b4, that it's still not all that easy. There is the a3 pawn is backwards, so black can maybe attack it, rook c3, and now centralize the king. And okay, maybe it is actually winning, but here there will probably be some technical difficulty. So I always thought it was better to avoid rook end games with pawn up. Of course, some rook end games are just very straightforwardly winning, but this, I'm not 100% sure this is one of them. So that's also why Capablanca played b4, and with this move gains control over the c5 square. And bishop d7, and here Capablanca followed another important endgame maxim, which is that the king gets a more important role in the endgame. The king is obviously not a very strong piece in the opening and early middle game, but when more pieces get exchanged, then the king will increase its strength, and now there is no risk for the king to get mated. It's time to centralize the king, and that's what Capablanca did with the move f4. Also gaining some space on the king side. King e7, king f2, rook a7, rook c3, king d6, and rook d3. This move is pushing the black king back. King e7 was great, and king e3. And this is where I stop. Capablanca converted this position with an extra pawn.